Nine political editor Chris Uhlmann is this morning continuing his series of live political interviews in the lead up to the 2022 federal election. Today he's in Brisbane with opposition leader Anthony Albanese. Good morning, Chris.
Morning, Charles. Anthony Albanese, welcome.
Good morning.
The election should be called this week. You could be Prime Minister in 52 days. Why should Australians take a risk on you?
I have a plan for a better future. I have a plan where no one will be left behind and no one held back. A plan to build new industries through cheaper, cleaner energy, fixing the NBN, cheaper childcare, making sure we strengthen Medicare, and importantly as well, as we announced this week, a plan to fix the crisis in aged care.
One of the things that you say is that real wages are going down under this government, the prices are going up. Can you pledge that real wages will go up under Labor?
Well, what you can pledge is to put in place mechanisms that put upward pressure on wages rather than downward pressure. This government has said that low wage growth is a key feature of their economic architecture. So by having secure work as part of the Fair Work Act, making sure that you properly define casualisation, guaranteeing that people should be paid the minimum wage, having same job, same pay provisions, all of these will make a positive difference.
Can you pledge that prices will go down?
Well, inflation, of course, there is inflationary pressure on there. But what you need to do in order to have economic growth, whilst taking into account taking pressure off inflation, is to grow productivity. And that's why so many of the measures that we've put forward, such as childcare, are about increasing productivity, increasing workforce participation, increasing the things that will make a positive difference, just like restructuring the NBN. Just like other areas, like fixing energy in this policy, will put downward pressure on prices so that $275 reduction, for example, in electricity by 2025, that's been modelled by Reputex. So it's not just us saying it, we've had that independent.
But on that, you're looking at completely retooling the system, the entire transmission system. Won't prices inevitably go up because of that? Because you're taking transmission costs will rise. There will have to be different mixes of power. As coal-fired power plants close down, prices will rise.
No, we've done the modelling and they show that prices will go down. And the benefit of what we're doing is, with our Rewiring the Nation plan, is we haven't just come up with this in a vacuum. This is the work that's been done by the Australian Energy Market Operator. They have an integrated systems plan. It's all out there. And today you have, from the Prime Minister, a one-off announcement on Marinus Link, which is a good project. They've been talking about it for a long time. They haven't actually done anything about it. They promised it last election. What we have is a plan to fix electricity transmission in this country that will bring the grid into the 21st century and put downward prices, whether it be for households or businesses.
Isn't one of the risks that you face going into this expectations? You will recall the election in 2007. You will recall two pledges, fuel watch and grocery choice. Both of them aimed at kitchen table economics, both of them aimed at bringing prices down, and neither of them worked.
Well, that's correct, and that's why they weren't sustainable into the longer term. What we've done, we're not promising the world here, Chris. What we're promising is practical reforms that make a difference. And in energy, they're based upon what the experts say. And what we know is that over the life of this government, they've had 22 energy policies. They haven't landed one of them. We still don't have an energy policy for this country. We've got one policy. It's been fully modelled. It's been backed by the Business Council of Australia, Australian Industry Group, ACCI, the National Farmers Federation, as well as the ACTU. It shows how I can bring the different forces in society together for our common interest.
On aged care, you're saying that you'll have a nurse in every nursing home 24/7. How many nurses would you need to find?
Well, what we do is follow the recommendation of the Royal Commission. And the question is this, Chris. Don't you think that Australians wonder why there isn't a nurse in every nursing home 24/7?
Certainly, but they might also wonder where you'll get nurses.
It's just common sense. Well, part of our policies that were out there as well is to increase education and training. We have 20,000 additional university places in areas of skill shortage. One of those is, of course, in nursing. We have 465,000 fee-free TAFE places. Many of those areas and areas of the care economy.
Do you know how many nurses you'll need in order to deliver that, just that one promise?
Look, the sector will grow. So it's not a static figure, Chris. What we know is that over a period of time, we have an ageing of the population. We've got to prepare for that. And at the moment, there's no plan from this government. What stuns me is that you have a Royal Commission established reluctantly by the government, and then they haven't bothered to follow through on the recommendations
of
that Royal Commission.
One of the other things that you say you'll do is to increase the wages of the workforce. Now, you said the other night some of them get just $22 an hour. They're after a 25% pay increase, so 200,000 workers, $5 an hour extra. Have you costed what that will be for that sector?
Well, we fully costed our plan that we announced on Thursday night.
For
it was
wages,
a total cost of $2.5 billion.
But that's not a wage bill.
No, a wage increase will be granted by the Fair Work Commission, and whoever is in government will have to fund that. But you've got to look at the opportunity cost as well, Chris. What the Royal Commission found was that unless you increase the wages of people in the aged care sector, you won't have a workforce. We're already seeing people leave the aged care workforce, the aged care sector, because of the pressure that's on them. So that's why you have to increase wages, you have to guarantee 215 minutes of care in accordance with the Royal Commission guidelines. You need to make sure that you have transparency and accountability in the sector in accordance with what the Royal Commission
And all of that is
said.
Necessary and good, but essentially there is a large unfunded cost there at the moment. You're also going to spend...
That's there.
Yeah.
Chris, in terms of wages, for whoever is in government, and the Prime Minister had to concede that on Friday. The question is this: why is it that this Prime Minister can't say that aged care workers deserve a wage increase?
You would also spend more on Medicare, more on the National Disability Insurance Service, more on childcare. So how are you going to fund this when the country already is pushing towards $1 trillion worth of debt and we have deficits locked in for at least the next decade?
Well, take childcare. Every dollar spent on childcare, every economic analysis shows it produces more than $2 return to the national economy. It's not just money out, it increases the money in. By increasing the workforce, by increasing productivity, by increasing growth of those businesses and companies, which is why it is supported by the business community so strongly. And in particular as well, if we're going to have a fair society, the idea that a woman who's in work, a mum, gets an actual cost for working a fourth or a fifth day is something that's not sustainable going forward. It stops
something
them advancing in their careers.
Something else that's not sustainable is that we keep spending at the rate that we're spending now.
I agree.
So you have a plan. How do you plan to try and get the budget back in control?
Well, the big difference between us and the government is that the government have these one-off payments that all end as soon as people cast their ballot papers. The government's been prepared to splash money around on commuter car parks where there aren't even train stations and a range of other measures. What we've done is clearly identify for spending issues that will produce a return, be it fixing the energy grid, be it fixing childcare, be it productive investment in infrastructure. That's why those programs have been a priority for us. And I've been very measured, I've been targeted in our spending, because I know that over a period of time, I know what it's like to value every single dollar in my life, and I've taken that approach to government.
When I look at this election campaign, and if I was to boil it down to where it seems to land on most days, it's a choice between a pathological liar, which is what the Labor Party seems to be calling the government, and a gutless fraud, which is what the Prime Minister essentially has dubbed you. That's a pretty low-rent campaign, isn't it?
Well, the critique of Scott Morrison, of course, is coming from his own side. It's coming from people who know him best. People who know me best know that what you see is what you get. I also have a record. I have 25 years in the Parliament, and I have 6 years as a senior minister in the government, including being the Deputy Prime Minister, including being the government leader of the House who presided over legislation. And what I did as a minister was create Infrastructure Australia, create the Regional Development Australia model, bring people together for that positive change, I invested in programs that make a productive difference to the economy, and I'm proud of that record.
You have a lifetime in the Labor Party's left. The government says that you would be the most left-wing Prime Minister that we've had. And let's just look at one of the issues that seems to energise the left at the moment, identity politics. What's your view on this constant recourse to cancelling people who have a different view from those in the left of your party?
Well, what we need to do is to respect every individual for who they are and not engage in that sort of cancel culture. It doesn't move things forward, it just divides society. And one of the things...
So I should be allowed to say pregnant women rather than pregnant people and not be cancelled?
Of course you should.
And should we be allowed to say things like men can't have babies?
Of course. And my view is very clear, that Labor has to represent mainstream Australia. And I'll tell you what, Chris, when you get away from some of the Twitter debate, I think Australians just respect each other for who they are and they get on with things. You go into any primary school in the country and I always get enlivened by it because people are enriched by our diversity, by people just being who they are.
You face a very difficult world if you become Prime Minister. One of the things we've seen recently is China in the region, the talk of a military base there. Would you be prepared to blockade any attempt by China to build a military base in the South Pacific if it came to that?
Well, I'll tell you what I would have done, Chris. I would have not withdrawn from engagement in the region in the way this government has by cutting aid and by cutting our diplomatic services in the region. We will need to rebuild the Foreign Service. Australia historically has punched way above our weight in the region. It's important that we work with our allies. The fact that you have a potential of a base being in our region, of which there is no justification for China to have that permanent presence in the Solomons, is of real concern.
But don't we have to draw red lines because we didn't in the South China Sea and China militarised it? At some stage, Australia was going to have to say this far and no further.
Well, it's occurred on this government's watch. And what amazes me, Chris, is the government, in spite of the fact they've given up governing and are just campaigning, that they actually are still the government. Which ministers have been dispatched to the Solomons to engage over recent weeks? Why is this not an absolute priority for this government? They've dropped the ball. It's one thing to have the rhetoric, but you need to engage with our friends and neighbours in the Pacific. Historically, Australia, along with New Zealand, have played a leading role in the region, and it is important that we do so in the future.
Clearly, given everything that's got to happen with the NDIS, Medicare that you talk about, with foreign affairs needing to be rebuilt, with spending more money on defence, that at some stage, some government's going to have to make some really tough choices and either cut services or lift taxes.
Well, what you need to do is to cut the waste. And this government have so much waste out there. They prioritise politics rather than actual growth, rather than productivity. Even in their infrastructure program, they've abandoned effectively the Infrastructure Australia model. The first thing they did when they came to office was cut programs, some of which aren't sexy, but ones that make a real productive difference. Like the Managed Motorways program had projects cut that had a double-digit benefit cost ratio. That is, one of them for every dollar invested will produce $13 for the national economy. Now we need to get around to fixing that. The NBN, they cut the NBN, but it ended up costing double what they said they would.
We are going to have to cut it there. But can you, in a sentence for us, just give us your elevator pitch on why Labor should be in government?
Labor should be in government because we have a plan for the future. We have a plan to grow the economy. We have a plan as well for an economy that works for people, not the other way around.
Anthony Albanese, will consider this a continuing conversation. There's a long way to go yet in this election, so catch up with you along the way. And back to you, Charles and Joan.
Thank you, Chris. So let's bring in our 4BC breakfast host, Neil Breen, and the Daily Telegraph's Claire Armstrong for their analysis. Welcome to you both. Breeny, you're here in the studio. We'll start with you. What struck me there, one of the things that Anthony Albanese said early on was, we're not promising the world here, we're promising practical reforms. He's trying to make himself a small target. Is that going to work?
Well, it's working so far. If you look at the polls, what he has to do and the narrative he has to come up with is that he's not Bill Shorten. Shorten should have won in 2019, but franking credits, various taxation policies scared the electorate. He's not trying to do that. Mm. But what struck me was he's going to spend here, nurses, this, that and the other. And when it comes to cuts, oh, waste. We'll cut waste. What waste? Yeah. You know what I mean? There is waste, but where, you know? Yeah.
Claire, Tony Abbott campaigned on stopping the waste back in 2010 in that election against Julia Gillard. Does that fly, that answer, when it comes to how you pay for all these things, or are we just going into more debt?
I think to an extent it does. I mean, when you look at Labor's platform so far, they haven't had a huge suite of measures. They've been very targeted. And if you want to have a side-by-side comparison, there were no cuts in Scott Morrison's budget handed down last week either. So it's definitely a question worth asking. But at this point, I'd say it's one but worth asking both sides of politics.
Claire, there is this view, rightly or wrongly, that the Coalition are better at managing money. Do you think Anthony Albanese can overcome that?
I mean, it's always going to be a problem for a Labor leader to mount that argument because the Liberal coalition has so, like, as you say, wholesomely kind of taken over that space in politics. But when you look at the fact that we are nearly $1 trillion in debt, when you look at the huge amount of spending that has had to happen because of the pandemic, you have to ask, you know, when you see things like JobKeeper going to companies that probably didn't need it and issues like that, that there is a bit more wiggle room to maybe for Labor to move into that space and have a conversation about how they would deal with the economy, given they're not coming up against, you know, a coalition that had the budget and surplus and the economy in a really strong position.
Bruni, the two states where the most seats are up for grabs, you talked to both parties, WA, Queensland, two very popular Labor premiers in those states. How valuable is Anastasia Palaszczuk in your state of Queensland or Mark McGowan going to be to Anthony Albanese?
Very.
And how should he lean into it?
Very. Particularly in Queensland, and obviously I host radio in Queensland, the government there is running a policy at the moment of attacking the coalition at every turn, whether it's to do with anything they do. The Olympics this, something else that, spending here, healthcare there, it's all about anti-Morrison, and it's all about getting some seats back in Queensland. And I think for Albanese, the key thing for him is this is very similar to 07. We've got a tired government, and the Howard government was getting tired. Suddenly it was on the nose. The difference is Anthony Albanese's been around a long time. He's not the shiny new thing Kevin Rudd was. And it's whether he can just maintain and just try and stay out of the news for the wrong reasons, such as Mean Girls. And I think he might have passed that now. I think he's in the box seat, Albo.
That very stark question from Chris Uhlmann, pathological liar or gutless fraud, is this voters voting on the leader's character, or are we actually going to look at their policies and make our decisions that way, do you think?
Well, I think it's a question for Claire, that the Daily Telegraph, which is a paper for the people, and if you go out into the suburbs, you know, like there's the political sort of people are engaged in it on Twitter and they're watching this show and that show. Then you go out to the suburbs, go to a shopping centre, and they're just picking up little bits and pieces. Oh, he's a liar. Oh, he's this. You know what I mean?
What do you think, Claire?
Yeah, I think, as always, despite the fact we don't have a presidential system of politics here, that the character of the leader does inform a lot of people's vote. They don't have the time, the energy to be engaged with every little policy development that either side come up with. So character does become really important, because the way our whole system works is you're basically trusting a small group of people to represent you and your values. Having said that, it is then the job of those leaders to try and reach people with their policy, if only a few of the, you know, their key measures, so that people can have a bit more of an understanding of what either side offers.
Well, this time next week, we will be officially into the campaign and then off and running until mid-May. Bruni, Claire, great to speak to you both today.
Thank you.
Thank you.